In this video, we're talking about different types of chemical reactions. So one way of classifying chemical reactions, there's several ways. So we can classify most chemical reactions according to one of the following types: combination, decomposition, single replacement, which sometimes you'll see called single displacement, means the same thing, double replacement or double displacement, and combustion. So we're going to go through these one at a time. In a combination reaction, what happens is two, or once in a while more than two, but usually just two things combine to make one. So we might write it like this: A plus B goes to C. Now, examples here would be nitrogen gas plus hydrogen gas making ammonia gas. And I've balanced these equations, all these equations already for you. And so two things, nitrogen and hydrogen, combining to make one, ammonia. Or solid magnesium oxide and gaseous carbon dioxide combining to make magnesium carbonate, solid. A decomposition reaction is just the opposite of a combination reaction. In a decomposition reaction, one thing breaks apart into two or more different things. Examples that you may or may not have seen already in a lab. For example, copper 2 hydroxide, when you heat it up, remember this triangle means you heat it up, right? Decomposes into copper 2 oxide and gaseous water. So in lab, we do is we take some copper 2 hydroxide, which is a kind of greenish blue solid powder, and when we heat it up, we get copper 2 oxide, which is black. And what you see is, if you do this in a test tube, you see a ring of vapor usually forming at the top. That's the steam, the water gas that's escaping. Another example of a decomposition reaction is in general, when you take hydrates, remember what a hydrate is. For example, here, the .520 H2O, excuse me, tells you it's a hydrate. Copper 2 sulfate pentahydrate. When you heat up hydrates, the waters leave. So remember, this bullet means these five waters are attached to this copper 2 sulfate. So when we heat it up, we make copper 2 sulfate anhydrous copper 2 sulfate, a solid, and five water molecules that are gas, and they escape. This stuff right here, copper 2 sulfate pentahydrate, is a beautiful bright blue color. Copper 2 sulfate anhydrous without the waters, it's actually white if it's really dry. Another example of a decomposition reaction that involves what's called a catalyst. Here the potassium iodide is the catalyst. And so I write it over the arrow because it's not really involved directly as a reactant, but it enables the reaction to happen more readily, faster. So this is hydrogen peroxide, that's what this molecule is. And when you place it in, aqueous hydrogen peroxide in with some potassium iodide, it decomposes into water and oxygen gas. And so what you'll see is see a bunch of bubbles coming up. Now the potassium iodide here, it'll give it a color, it'll give it a reddish tinge, but that's not a color change due to that chemical reaction. The bubbles are the really only sign of this chemical reaction. Now, single replacement or single displacement reaction, what happens is an element that's all by itself, something in its elemental form, displaces that same type of element in an ionic compound. For this class, the type of element that's by itself will either be a metal or a halogen, fluorine, chlorine, bromine, or iodine. So, for example, aluminum reacting with hydrochloric acid. The aluminum is the element by itself. It's a metal. So what you do is you look for the same type of element. Here, hydrogen is acting as a cation in the acid, so it's acting like a metal in this case. And so what's going to happen is the aluminum will displace the hydrogen. Now, over here, notice aluminum, metal, solid, has no charge. Hydrogen has a +1 charge in hydrochloric acid. When the aluminum displaces the hydrogen, the aluminum gets a positive charge. And we know from the octet rule that aluminum will lose 3 electrons, so it has a +3 charge, and each chloride has a -1, so that's why we have this formula here, aluminum chloride, +3 from the aluminum, -1 from each chloride, so we need 3 of these guys to balance the charge. And then hydrogen without a charge, okay, it's one of the Hofbräkel elements, the 7 diatomic elements, so that's why it's H2, okay, not just H. And that's the only way you know that is because you memorized Hofbräkel, or the 7 diatomic elements. And again, I've balanced it for you with the coefficients. Here, in this reaction, the element that's by itself is a halogen, bromine. It ends up bromine's a liquid at room temperature and pressure. And the ionic compound is potassium iodide. So here, because bromine is a halogen, we're looking for a halogen in this compound, in this case the iodide. And so bromine will replace iodide, and we get potassium bromide. Now, bromide is, again, one of the seven diatomics, so it's Br2, Hofbräuchel. Here, iodide has a negative one, potassium has a positive one. So when bromine replaces iodide, it becomes the bromide ion with a negative one charge, potassium with a positive one. When they balance the charges, we get KBr. And iodine is also one of the Hofbräuchel, or seven diatomics, so it's I2. And it ends up that iodine's a solid when it's in its elemental form. And here, this is another example that you may have seen in lab. That's zinc metal and copper 2 sulfate aqueous. Here the zinc displaces the copper and becomes zinc sulfate and solid copper. Now, in a single displacement reaction, if it happens in one direction, so the zinc will displace copper and you'll see zinc sulfate and copper metal, it will not happen in the reverse reaction. So if we were, for some reason, to take copper metal, put it into a solution of zinc sulfate, nothing would happen. So these single replacement reactions only go in one direction. Double replacement or double displacement reactions. Here, basically what's happening is, well, you have two ionic compounds, and the way to think about a double replacement reaction is to think about the cations as switching places. They go with the other anion. So for example here, calcium chloride aqueous and sodium phosphate aqueous, again you should have seen this in the lab, is a double replacement reaction, and you know it's a double replacement reaction because it's two ionic compounds. And so the calcium will go with the phosphate. Now calcium has a plus two charge, phosphate has a negative three. So when we combine these two, you know, you can do the X if you want to, you balance the charges, you get this formula here, three calciums and two phosphates. Notice the parentheses, and it ends up that's a solid. We'll talk, by the way, we'll talk in a later module about how we know if it's a solid or aqueous. Don't worry about that yet. And the other cation here, we did the calcium switching places with the sodium. So now the sodium's gonna go with the chloride. Now this three here, it's just to balance the charges, the three negatives on the phosphate. That's the only reason we have a three here. When the sodium ion, which looks like this, combines with chloride, which looks like this, we get just sodium chloride. Once more, I've balanced the equation for you guys. Another type of double replacement reaction, also called, surprisingly, an acid-base reaction, because it's an acid and a base, involves an acid and a base. So whenever you take an acid, for example, hydrochloric acid and sodium hydroxide, a base, and you combine them, you know, it's just a double replacement reaction. The hydrogen is the cation in here, and it switches places with the sodium, and it goes in front of the hydroxide. Well, HOH is the same as H2O, right? So the hydrogen replaced the sodium and made water, and the sodium cation replaced hydrogen combined with chloride to make sodium chloride. The last type of chemical reaction we'll talk about here is called combustion. And what it means is that you have a hydrocarbon, or sometimes just hydrogen, reacting with oxygen. And because there is oxygen in the air, a lot of, you know, combustion reaction happens readily in our atmosphere. Ethanol, C2H5OH, is a liquid. When it combusts or burns, reacts with oxygen, O2 gas, again, Hofbräuchel, it makes carbon dioxide and water. So here's the thing to memorize. When the combustion of a hydrocarbon, the products are always carbon dioxide and water. Write that down. It's really important. That's the only way you know what the products are if you're trying to figure out what the products of a combustion reaction are. If it's a hydrocarbon reacting with oxygen, the products are always carbon dioxide gas and water gas, and then you balance it from there. Now, hydrogen will also combust, and there's no carbon, so it doesn't make any carbon dioxide. In this case, the product is just water. And you guys did this reaction in lab, in the evaporating dish, you burned the ethanol, and this, one of the other reactions, produced hydrogen gas. When you stuck the wood splint in there, the lighted wood splint, this reaction happened.